little bit about what influences size structure in walleye and yellow perch today. So, walleye and yellow perch are common cool water predator prey combination found throughout lakes and reservoirs in North America. These two species are important ecologically and are of also interest to both recreational and commercial fisheries. So walleye are the primary predator of young of the year yellow perch in many of the New York water bodies. And yellow perch become vulnerable to predation by walleye when they reach a total length of about 18 millimeters. And most of what we know about this relationship between walleye and yellow perch is based on long-term studies in Oneida Lake. But because they are cool water species, they have a wide distribution. And because of this distribution, we can find them in shallow eutrophic lakes, deep glaciated lakes, and as many of you know, the Great Lakes. And because of this, they are intensively studied. Walleye, for example, have been intensively studied for top control and are stocked for biocontrol of landlocked paddle wife and for recreational fishing. Let me back up. Most of our New York water bodies that have walleye and yellow perch lack usable life history information. And the life history information that we were concerned about for this study was length. And the reason for that is you can categorize things by length. And few people before Gable House had an intuitive method to subdivide game fish into quality lengths. And it wasn't until he adopted Anderson Weithman's method in 78 to approach stock assessment using link frequency, where managers able to better estimate more precise estimates for PSD indices. And so one of the great things about length is it's easy, we can go out and measure it, but in our management, we have kind of set it up to where it defines legal size at harvest. So it's one of the metrics that is most commonly used. So besides being a convenient way to numerically summarize link frequency data, it also allows us to facilitate comparisons of like PSDs between populations. And so many of us, I feel like, to define legal size or have some type of length limit on fish kind of influences our PSDs, and our PSDs have specific biological interpretation that have been empirically linked to studies that have shown they're linked to certain functional rates like growth, reproduction, and recruitment. And my big takeaway here is look at how we have treated PSDs in the past. And so the first thing I want to talk a little bit about is that PSDs are not normal. Normal distributions between negative infinity and infinity. PSDs are bound between 0 and 100 or 0 and 1. And so that's the first thing. The second thing is that we use them to calculate a number, but we have no idea what is influencing that, our PSD estimates. And so we have these PSD estimates for years with our confidence intervals, but we don't exactly know what are driving these PSD estimates. And the last thing I'd like to touch on is the stats that we have used, and the techniques have kind of lagged behind in the research questions that we can answer. We don't use or supplement our data with things like relative weight and growth. So we're just kind of taking a snapshot. And sorry guys, where we lack in our research questions, we can't exactly say for certain what it is that are influencing our estimates. So when we get here and analyzing our trends, we have concerns about what our numbers mean. And so in response to like the concerns that Region 4 had about recruitment and stock structure of persons. Our goal was to just study ways to demonstrate the utility of Bayesian hierarchical models so we could provide better estimates and look at trends over long periods of time in New York State. Our specific objectives were to just develop a simple yet flexible model that we could come up with a framework in analyzing our trends in PSD, and not only that, but look at the uncertainty that comes with it. And two was to explain the variability in that the distribution in time and space, so year effect, lake effect, and this framework will allow us to answer our current like management questions surrounding PSD. So we evaluated walleye and perch link frequency data from 14 lakes and reservoirs within Region 4. These water bodies were unique in their own right in that they were different size, lake type, classification, productivity, and the amount of usable information that they had. Some of these water bodies have been fortunate enough to have been studied or some type of person management or stocking program since the 70s. For example, DEC, Cornell's Biological Field Station, and Cooper's Biological Field Station. And this is important because it provides us with information that we are able to share across regions with lakes that have no data. So we used the statewide database to obtain walleye and yellow perch link data from 91 to 2014. And our final number of observation was approximately 1,900. And we also included data from 2011 to 2017, that were not yet available to the database. So this is stuff that we have collected in the last couple of years and some data that was just kicking around. So we used this data and we developed a hierarchical Bayesian binomial logistic regression model, or a GLMM, generally mixed model. And we were able to facilitate an analysis, estimate PSDs regionally, and so we can get a regional average, and where the outcome is equal to the number of quality size fish out of the number of stock size fish based on some type of probability. And that is what PSD is. So once we plugged it into our formula, we were able to get our numbers, and we had to do a couple adjustments. And really, we just transformed the data so we could plot our lake-specific mean PSDs, and then we transformed it again, so from the logit scale back to the probability scale, so we could plot our predictions and our posterior predictions. So here you can see, so for the rest of the talk, the blue line will be our mean, and our red lines are upper and lower 95% credible intervals, or CRIs. And here you can see that the mean PSD for walleye is about 78, and these are our lake-specific estimates. So here's the 14 lakes and reservoirs. And you can see regionally that walleye stocks are kind of out of balance. And the red lines are, in this case, they are not the 95% CRIs. They are the actual range of balance for PSDs. So this is the values where we would want to be. So you can see that PSDs across the region are high. This graph is set up so we have year across the x-axis and our PSD across the y-axis. This is our year-specific PSD estimates, and you can see that the circles are the effective sample size. So the bigger the circle, the bigger the sample. And you can see that the solid black line is our mean PSD, and you can generally see that it has increased over time. And the associated dash lines are the upper and lower 95% CRIs. And you can see back in the late 90s, we have this really wide gap between our dash lines. That is the amount of uncertainty we had back in the 90s, because the amount of information we had on this these populations back then was limited. And as we go through time, and we pick up samples, and we do surveys, we can see that our uncertainty kind of narrows. And so what we wanted to do was look at one specific lake. And the lake we chose was Canada Regal Lake. It's a data-rich site. It has so much data that I don't even know what to do with it. But it's located in southeastern New York. It's in Region 4. It's about 770 hectares and 380 meters above sea level. Mean depth, 7.5 meters, max depth, 13, 14 meters. Generally in June, July, and August, the hypovolemia is anoxic. But the takeaway here is that it has 37 species of fish, so it has a real diverse community. And before the introduction of alewife, yellow perch and various sunfish species were the primary or dominant forage fish, and walleye were the dominant predator. So in developing this model, we see that our binomial logistic regression model, or GLM, for this study, so that we could facilitate an analysis to look at walleye PSD regionally. And we proceeded as before, like with the GLMM, but this time we dropped the random effects and we fixed effects of year and alewife CPUV. And then this gives us the opportunity to see how the fishery has changed over the last two decades. Here our graphs are set up the same way. We have our blue line representing the mean PSD. Our dashed red lines are the upper and lower 95% credible intervals. And you can see here that we failed to detect, we can see the effect of year, but we can't see or detect an effect of alewife abundance. So we're kind of left scratching our heads. But we know that the fishery has an overabundant yellow perch population. And so it's been documented that high abundance of yellow perch have been able to buffer predation of walleye on other species, or potential prey species, for example, alewife. And here we go to, and so we wanted, so from that point, we jumped and looked at yellow perch size structure. And so here we're looking at yellow perch PSDs, and you can see that our PSDs have decreased over time, and that walleye PSDs have increased our yellow perch PSDs have decreased over time. And we presume that it has coincided with the presuming, they started stocking again. Back in the 80s, Canada Regal Lake had a self-sustaining fishery after being stocked. They stopped stocking it, and so we went back and looked at all that data, and we have this trend decreasing over time, and it kind of overlaps with when the stocking started again, but it could really be a number of reasons. It could also be predation by alewife on larval yellow perch. So there's a couple reasons, but that's why this framework is unique or novel. We're able to look at more than one or more independent variables. And so here we have our, going off that last graph, we wanted to look at alewife to see if they had an effect on yellow perch PSD. And you can see that for sure we have a decrease in PSD as our mean CPUE increases. So kind of determined that the yellow perch size structure was largely explained by this increase in mean PSDs, but it could really be, it's, it could be another kind of variable that we're not looking at. And so we looked at our posterior predictions, and we took this tic-tac-toe plot and kind of adapted it from Ogle. And the parallel lines are the range of balance that you would like to see in your fish, in your fishery or your communities. And you can see that we started somewhere, you know, I guess in balance, but it never really stayed there. And you can see the general trend. We are moving from this quadrant here is, there's many interpretations, but it's large, older specimens, typically maybe of an unfished fishery. But we know that this lake doesn't go unfished. So, but we also see this trend where it's going down to the second quadrant, and that has a little bit more interpretation where our overabundant stunted prey are interfering with our predator reproduction. So by sharing our information across lakes, we're able to estimate our PSDs in systems where we otherwise couldn't, where we just lacked usable life history information or because of data limitations or no data at all. But even though, you know, these models aren't perfect, they are based on our surveys, so they provide valuable reference points based on regional information. And so our framework has a statewide application in that we have dozens of lakes that lack, you know, usable life history information, you know, lengths, weights, all that good stuff. And we could also benefit because we can apply this framework to multiple species within our database. And so we took the same approach, and we found like we were successful in that this could be easily extended to, for example, region 3 or region 2, or management questions that have or are aligned with the same concerns like recruitment and stock structure. And it was in that we saw that we were successful in investigating. When we investigated our spatial and temporal trends, we saw that our models were successful. We could see the trends in walleye and yellow perch PSDs. But we also can include